Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where I'm going to give you the overview of my solar powered carport that charges both my Nissan Leaf and runs my cabin during the day. So right now, everything around you here is being run directly from the sun and the car is being charged. Now this project has been just filled with rabbit holes and challenges in terms of working with a DC system. Issues with the electrics in my cabin that I had to change so that I could integrate the solar power system into my cabin or studio. There are so many rabbit holes. As you know, I've already kind of got some sub videos where I've gone into some details about the inverter and what have you, but there are going to be several other ones where I go into issues relating to DC circuitry, DC protection systems, breakers, cheap breakers of Amazon, which you perhaps need to be aware of, ground fault protection, DC arc fault protection, and the high risk of fires with DC arrays. So I'm going to kind of spoil this before I end off and tell you my feelings about this whole setup, is that I personally wouldn't, and I would say avoid going with a DC array. Micro inverters to me are a far better solution. I've had two reasonable size DC arrays previously in South Africa, then in Ohio. I installed my own micro inverter system with the Outback inverter, which was a really nice simple solution, virtually plug and play. And now going back to a DC system, it is a minefield of things you need to be aware of. But I say, I'll try and cover off some of those, but I don't want to get too bogged down. We're going to do some walk and talk and I'll show you the system. Just a quickie before we walk outside. So what prompted this? I bought the Nissan Leaf just over a year ago. I thought at the time I wouldn't be able to drive it up here because I had a gravel driveway. I kind of got it halfway and realized, I may as well park halfway down the driveway, but it's going to be in the sun, so let me build a carport. And I said, well, if I'm going to build a carport, can I solar charge the car? And then once I managed to drive the vehicle up here, and I thought, wow, if I could get it up here and do the solar power carport here, it could charge the car and maybe partially run the cabin. So that's prompted me to build the driveway. I've done videos on that. So I've got the car up here, and then the calculation was, well, will a carport have enough solar on it to charge the car for my work to home commute? Bearing in mind, my Nissan Leaf has about a 20 kilowatt hour battery pack in it. My drive to work and home, my commute, is about 17.2 miles. My car has an efficiency of anywhere between about 4 to 4.5 miles per kilowatt hour. Now, the interesting thing is the energy required to actually charge it up again for that 17.2 mile trip, I've measured twice, and once when I charged it, it was about 5.8 kilowatt hours. So I was working on, I'd need 6 kilowatt hours, and then I've seen it take 6.5 kilowatt hours. So I went out and I did the calculation on how big an array, and I've managed to fit a 5.2 kilowatt array. But I face the challenge. I'm on the lee side of a hill and I've got trees around me. I do have a fair view of the sky, but I only see the sun later in the day. Now in summer, it's probably around 10 o'clock. It's above the trees. Right now, it is just past 12:30. It is the worst time of year. Shorter days, the angle of the sun is lower, and I've got all the leaves on the trees. In a few weeks' time, it'll be full. I reckon my energy will increase. But anyway, let's pop outside and I'll give you more of the facts and figures. Right, so before we do shoot outside, let me just show you what my studio or cabin is currently using. So it is using about 750 watts. It ranges between about 700 and I'd say 850 watts, depending on whether my inverter split unit air conditioner is running. They're fairly efficient. Obviously, if I run the microwave or make a cup of coffee, then you shoot up to, let's say, 2,000 watts. But generally speaking, my usage is fairly good. So there we go. There's the Nissan Leaf. It is busy charging. I've got a little charge station set up outside and I can plug in when I arrive. There is the solar array bathed in light at the moment. So at the moment, we're at 12:45. It is only just coming to full light. So what basically the issue that I sit with is I sit in the lee of a hill. So the opposite side, there's sun early in the morning, but the sun is only above the trees, as I say, at the moment at around 12:30. But that means I worked on, let's say, roughly generating, because of the angle is also, even though I've angled this up, it's obviously not at the ideal angle to the sun, and particularly now with the sun low in the sky, I see a maximum of about 4,000 watts, between 3 and 4,000 watts between 12:30 and let's say 3:30 in the afternoon. But that does give me enough to generate the power I need to charge the Nissan Leaf and run my cabin while the sun is up. And then what I do, as I mentioned in a previous video, I've got a fairly intricate system to force it back to the grid. Even though there is a setting for the inverter to go back to the grid, I have to force it because the array still produces a voltage long after the sun has gone down and it's producing no power, sucking, drawing energy out of the batteries. So I've got a system I'll show you inside where I force it across to the grid so that I don't run the batteries down. It generates for me, yesterday was a kind of an interesting day. It was cloudy and hazy, and that can provide more power actually early in the morning and after the sun's gone down behind the trees because you've got light dispersion in the sky. It generated about 9 kilowatt hours. And I say that's enough to charge the vehicle and run the cabin and put some charge back into the batteries. I reckon in once the leaves fall off, that might go to 10 or just over 10 kilowatt hours. And in summer, I think somewhere between 12 to 15, but we'll see when we get there. Right, so in order to hook this up, I dug a little trench, which goes to my main service entry over here. And if we have a look inside, I have a 40 amp breaker, which is going to feed 240 volts. It goes down through some flexible conduit, which you can bury and is watertight. So that goes down to my kind of smaller cabin, I now call the powerhouse. It goes back there, and then a feed from what I now call the powerhouse comes back, and I'll show you where it enters into the studio. This is the generator input that I asked the electrician to install. And I'm going to take you now inside to my breaker box just to show you what's required, certainly by code and for safety, which wasn't done when the electrics on my cabin were done. So this is something I'll cover off in more detail. But basically here is the flexible conduit that comes in, which feeds the cabin. So I switch over to this feed. I obviously run off this feed permanently now because this can either get the power from the solar or the inverter and batteries, or the inverter goes into a bypass mode where it directly feeds the grid back in here. Now just be mindful of this little rubber cap where I've removed the generator input with the positive pins, which would have been here, and realize that these positive pins would have been here. And when I explain the setup inside, you'll realize the risk of the way this was set up. Right, so over here in my breaker box, this is the main 200 amp breaker, which this is back to back with the service entry on the outside. So there's a breaker on that outside unit, and then there's a feed into here into this 200 amp breaker, which then feeds your circuits. This I mentioned in a previous video, I had to carefully then balance between the phases. Your phases, you've got a ladder of conductors in here, each one alternating between live one and live two. And hence, when you put a breaker across here, it goes across both those phases so that you get your 240 volts. So here you can see I've got the inverter input at the top here with a mechanical interlock. Now, the electricians who did the work on my cabin installed this several breakers down, which meant that this could be switched on with the mains on. And of course, there's several issues with that. For one, if this is on and that is on, that outside generator connector with the positive poles and 240 volts is live. You just pull that little rubber puck down, someone puts their hands there, it's potentially game over. So what I had to do was move one breaker down and extend the wiring inside, which is 6-gauge wiring, to bring this 50 amp breaker up here and then install this mechanical interlock. So basically the way this works is that you can only have one of these breakers on at a time. That then prevents you from one, having the outside live when it shouldn't be,
having, if you have this switched on and this switched on with a generator on, you're going to have problems. You're going to be feeding power into your generator. Things are going to be out of phase. Also, you can then also potentially backfeed energy from the generator into the grid, risking linesmen if you don't have this main breaker off. So this has to be installed there. Extending the wires, I had to go and research and buy some very special extension devices, which I'll show you. They've got a graphite grease in them. They're specially made for big gauge wire, and they are required if you're going to do a wire extension like I've had to do here by code. You cannot just use a simple block connector or something like that. There is something very specific, good insulation. So I'll show you that a little later.
Righty-ho, so we're going to take a closer look at the mounting of the panels and the wiring and what have you. But here we go, just to show you, I have the leaf plugged in. And if you have a look at the charge lights over there, it is busy filling up. Now then, I also just want to warn, and we're going to talk about this in other videos, I have, to the best of my ability, I've tried to do things according to the National Electric Code. But in some cases, I've deviated. And I've deviated for a reason, because the National Electric Code has been playing catch-up to solar. And the code has changed several times over the years. So just be mindful. Don't do as I have done on my system. You need to go and research it yourself, because the code has changed. And in some cases, people debate that what the code suggests, and it's my feeling as well, may actually impair a system or in fact make it dangerous. And we're going to talk about that in subsequent videos. But anyway, so here is my solar power mounting system. I've spoken about this before. I decided to avoid using mounting rails because of cost. I just used 90 degree angle brackets with stainless steel nut and bolts. I have loosened the mounting onto these cross members, or these trusses going across over here, because the wood is still drying out. It's going to move. And with them secured tightly, it would potentially place stress on the solar panels. So for the time being, I've left them loose. Maybe in a year's time, I'll tighten them up. They're not going to go anywhere. The wiring, you can see, I've managed to get nicely into lubes, right? So often you'll see the underside of solar panels, and particularly because you can see it because it's a carport, it can be really messy. So what I've done, I've gone and put this in lubes, but I want you to be mindful of something when doing something like this. The one big catch, and this is where we get down to arc fault protection, is if you have any breaks in your insulation of your wiring, whether it's rodent, weather, UV, you can easily have an arc fault. You can have a DC arc going across, and if there's anything flammable, that can cause a huge fire. You only have to go and research DC arc faults and solar arrays to see how many fires have been caused by this issue. And that's why we're going to do a separate video looking at DC arcs and the issue with trying to extinguish arcs and catering for arc faults. So what I wanted to highlight was, for one, I've had to carefully bind wires together, being mindful of not having too tight a loop, because you've got fairly stiff PV wiring, and if you have too tight a loop, you risk weakening the insulation. And if it does weaken or get a crack in it, you then obviously risk these arc faults. You'll see the slightly thicker profile over there. What I've done, this array split into two 5.2 kilowatts split up between the two inverters. I mentioned this in a previous video, because of the open circuit voltage rating of the panels versus what the inverter can handle, I had to have two panels connected in series. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 sets of panels connected in series, and then they're all connected in parallel. So that's so that I don't exceed, I think it's 145 volt open circuit DC to the inverters. This is kind of that, this sets my wrap for around 82 or 84 volts. But realistically, once you get to the equipment, the open circuit voltage is about 74. Now, this is important because the code requires that if you now operate over 80 volts, you need arc fault protection. But it's not easy to implement. And I challenge you to go and find a device that you can easily implement. I think you're going to struggle to find them. Well, I am. And that's why we're going to talk about it. But anyway, so these are all joined together. I've got combiners mounted here. So I combine part of the array up here, right under the eaves. And then we come down, and then I have a combiner box here, which does the final combining for basically two sets of four panels. I have in here a set of fuses and a breaker, and I'm using these Midnight Solar. These are CBI. They're actually produced in South Africa or Lesotho. These are rated for 50 amp. My array, potentially each half of it, is going to run at about 40 amp peak. But the code says you should rate your breakers at about 1.6 times in case you get excess current during very cold, bright weather. And that can easily happen, but my array, because it doesn't see the sun at a high angle, I doubt will ever even reach 50 amp. My wiring is gauged so that it can cater for far more than 50 amp. And all that's going to happen is if I do exceed 50 amp, I'm going to get nuisance trips. If that does happen, well, then I can obviously increase the rating of these breakers. But just be mindful. Pay money for good DC breakers. Even here, these ones which are kind of Midnight Solar branded are polarized. So if you open up this box, you'll see like either a positive and a negative, and it's not straightforward as to how to connect them. You basically have to, the positive is the side of the greatest potential. And that gets tricky because that could vary with a battery system. You can have your greatest potential changing between your solar array and your battery. And again, so that's why I want to cover off this whole issue of DC breakers. But anyway, I've got the 220 amp fuses here before it goes through this breaker, and then it runs off the side here to go to the cabin. And then I have surge suppression. So the one thing the code also mandates you do now is that you have, in case you have a big surge or there's a lightning strike, and this is where it gets controversial in terms of having an earth electrode and the number of earth electrodes, but I have just installed these this morning. So let me just show you something. Before I go to this, I'll show you my earth wiring on the panels. And again, I want to highlight, I've done this my way. And in some respects, the code can be has changed and can be very funny about what they want you to do. The one thing you need to be wary of is that, strictly speaking, you need solid core 6-gauge bare copper wire, as far as I know, for your earthing of your panels. And this is to protect if you get a ground fault. So let's say you have a positive conductor which touches the frames. You need somewhere for that to go so that you can have a trip. I'm going to explain more about that. Because having the ground fault protection doesn't necessarily make the array safe. Also, copper and aluminium react. You can have a galvanic reaction. In fact, if you have a look at photographs, you'll see how copper can literally cut through the frames of aluminium. So you need to be very careful that the copper doesn't directly touch the panels. You also have to break the anodizing of the frame or of your, if you've got a mounting system, there are very special pieces of metal that have to go between and cut through the galvanizing. So what I've done, I've gone and actually filed away to make sure, for one, I break through the anodizing. I've checked it with a multimeter. These lugs, which are aluminium, are tin coated and rated for copper. The one thing I also plan to do is to actually get a graphite grease to avoid any oxidation on these. But what I've done, I've got these connected in there. I've used machine screws. You can use machine screws. I've got special star crush washers to make sure they are there tight and stay there. Ideally, perhaps stainless steel nuts and bolts. These are stainless steel screws, but the code stipulates that you actually need, if you're going to use a machine screw, two of the threads have to engage with the frame, and these frames are very thin. So just be mindful of that. If you are going to use machine screws, which I'd say not the best thing, perhaps go with a stainless steel nut and bolt, because you don't have this issue with, in theory, with the code saying you need so many threads engaging with the frame. But all through here, that's how I mount it, and you can see I've got standoffs to take it away from the actual panels, and it only the connection is only made with the lugs. and nowhere does the copper touch the frames at all.
Right, so having this is the second combiner, and I've literally only just installed these Midnight Solar DC surge protectors. They are DC surge protectors. They can be used for AC. They have LEDs in them that glow. You might be able to see those LEDs. You can use them on AC, but then apparently the LEDs won't glow. But you can, if you want to, you can choose specific ones for AC or DC. You have to also be very specific about the voltage rating, whichever ones you choose. And so these are connected to the positive and the negative inside there, and then I've got it coming out and attached to my copper wire, ground wire over here. And in theory, this is where it gets interesting with the code. You should have an earth electrode right here. And that certainly makes sense if you're going to have a direct lightning strike. You want the earth as close as possible. Where it gets interesting is that the code has changed where potentially you need to place your earth electrode. And they do allow you, as long as you've got a continuous straight run, you can go to your service entry as long as it's a complete contiguous run of copper and then hook into existing earth electrode that way. The code does allow that, but double check for yourself. Sometimes local ordinances don't allow that. So why at the moment am I sticking to just one electrode? Potentially you can end up, if you have two earth electrodes, you can end up with a ground loop, and ground loops can cause issues. So at this point in time, I haven't got a separate electrode right here. I might change my mind in the future. Obviously, I've got the copper right here, so I can place a 6 foot or 8 foot electrode right down, right here, right next to the array. But I say, I want to do a little bit more research on ground loops. Righty-ho. So as we step in here, I've set up this little panel just because monitoring your production on your array can be a challenge in terms of energy and power monitoring, because there aren't that many good monitoring solutions. GrowWatt do offer a solution where you can add a Wi-Fi device, but then you have to sign on to their website. You upload all your data to them and you view it via their website. I don't want to do that. So for the time being, I've just repurposed this little case and I've mounted these two panels in here. This is going to be another video. As you can see, because the readings from the current shunt and the voltage readings tend to jump around, you'll sometimes notice it's not actually not too bad at the moment, but these power readings can jump around because you get subtle changes in the voltage and the current. You can see my energy readings at the moment. So this is literally only probably in the last hour or so, because I've only had full sunlight on it for a little while. But we are generating just over 3,000 watts at the moment. If we have a look at the car charger, you can see it is charging at a rate of 7.2 amps. This one, you can select 6, 8, 10, 13, or 16 amp. And I mentioned this before, I chose this because I run the risk of overrunning the power capability of these two inverters, because you're running 3,000 on each phase, and sometimes you may have a phase which gets overloaded, and that's where one inverter, and I've spoken about this in a previous video, one inverter may be better. One 6,000 watt inverter may be better. And I reckon, and I'll say this now because I have been fairly critical of these GrowWatt inverters. I've got a 4,000 watt Outback inverter at home, and I reckon it would do a better job of running my cabin and avoiding trips, because it has got a far better surge capability. But anyway, I've already mentioned that already. So just to show you with that running, so if we have a look at the moment, you can see the little power pole is disconnected. It's showing the solar panel is supplying power to charge the battery and to run the loads. So that's that little icon over there. So these are both running the loads, and the Seplos battery bank, which I must say, I've been very happy with, is now calibrated correctly. So if you watch my previous videos, you'll have realized that I was still in the point of trying to get everything balanced and calibrated. If you look at the differential, the voltage difference across the cells, it is only, you can see, 3, 4, 6 millivolts at the moment. And it has got a nice balance. There are four packs here at the moment, which is switching between. and these are the various current and voltage readings across each pack. And you can see how closely matched the voltage is across all of the packs as it goes through them. So I must say, I've been very, very chuffed. Again, if you haven't seen the previous videos, each of these packs can deliver about 5 kilowatt hours. I've got 20 kilowatt hours sat in this pack. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. I've done a fair few detailed videos on the Seplos batteries, but I must say, I've been very happy with them because I had this issue where I was hoping to intelligently link them up via CAN bus. I haven't been able to do that because of hardware issues on the GrowWatt inverters. So these are running, basically, they're running in a dumb mode. I've just got a charge voltage, a cutoff, and a float, and the internal BMS does all the management. I say, it manages the voltage across the cells and across the packs really, really well. Right, the wiring. Does that look like spaghetti junction? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to get a tripod and I'm going to explain the wiring and why it looks like it does. Right then, so for one, be mindful that I'm fairly sure that the code requires that your breaker boxes be at eye level, okay? So again, I'm not telling you to go, this is how to go and install your own system. I've done things in a certain way because I've got certain space limitations and what have you, but just be mindful that having your breaker boxes below eye level might be an issue. Nonetheless, so this is the AC breaker box, this is the DC breaker box. From outside, you'll have seen, obviously, where I was talking about my service entry. This is where the AC grid feed comes into the breaker box, and that is the feed back which runs my cabin. Then we've got the various breakers, which obviously I've got a breaker to break the AC coming in, the inverter going out, and I've got another breaker which controls whether the charger to the car is active or not. I've got a big power outlet for the charger for the car. Above that, I've got had to add, and this is where things get messy, because I wanted that metering, I've got two shunts in here. So all the wires which come down and read the voltage drop across those shunts comes in here. And then on the DC side, we have the array wiring coming in here. You'll see I've got some excess, and one might ask, why didn't I cut off the excess and go straight in there? I knew potentially I'd be doing some changes. And so that's come in handy because with the change with the breakers, I'm going to come in closer and explain the breaker setup for the DC side. I had to take the negative side of the array higher up to the shunts because only a positive was required for the DC ground fault protection over there. I also have a set of fuses, so if anything goes awry on the breakers, I've got the fuses as a backup, and in fact I've made a space over here to allow me to have a disconnect. So after I come through the fuses, I'm going to go through a disconnect, because if I'm ever working on here, if I remove that panel, there are still big conductors which are exposed and potentially live. So I've been like pulling the cables out of the battery pack. But a far more eloquent solution would be to have a DC disconnect, so that is what is going to go over there. One of the little rabbit holes has been DC breakers. So I certainly started off with these CBI breakers, which Midnight Solar have got specifically rated and tested for solar arrays, I think for both America and Canada. You can see that these are rated for 150 volts DC and 80 amp. And what they do, they gang two together. They have a big conductor so that they gang two 40 amp units together to carry the current. These are polarized. Now, again, be mindful that the code actually now really wants you to install non-polarized DC breakers, but there aren't many of those on the market. So again, this is something we're going to go into. I had a set of the cheaper DC breakers. These are for doing the battery. And I had a set of cheaper DC breakers over here switching the array. So as the array comes in, even though I've got disconnects outside, which need to be labeled. So if you ever have any fire brigade or anything coming to your house, they need to be able to disable your DC array. But I have these over here in place of the cheaper ones off Amazon, just because I just did not have any faith in how well they operate. And we are going to do some testing on those in a future video. So these are something which Midnight Solar came up with as a solution for ground fault protection. So these are interesting. These are two breakers ganged together, rated for 63 amp. Now the reason I point that out is that they specifically say you cannot use this as your overload protection because they use a fixed value here. You need to have another breaker in series with this to cater for your overload, which I have outside. They gang this together with a half amp breaker. These two switches are joined together. And what you do is this breaker, you can see these white wires going out the top. This breaker is connected to the negative of your battery. And at the bottom here, you'll see there are the green ground wires. These need to go to your equipment ground. And what this does is if you have a fault on your array, so let's say a rodent or UV broke through, let's say one of the positive cables, and your positive cable was touching your solar panel frame or your mounting system, that could become live. And potentially if someone could touch the array and they were grounded in such a way that they became a conductor, it could be life-threatening or very dangerous. So what this would do then is if you have a ground fault on the array, that passes through this breaker with a rating of half an amp. That would throw and then stop your array from operating. However, it doesn't remove the risk of shock or electrocution from the array. And in fact, if you have a look at the sticker which I've placed on the top, I've had to cut it in two to fit it on there, it details exactly that. So basically when the breaker breaks, you're stopping the array from operating, but the fault still basically exists on the array. And this is one of those fun gotchas where your protection system in the DC system like this has some caveats. So you need to be very careful and mindful of both a ground fault, and again, when we get into arc fault, how difficult it can be to resolve an arc fault, which can cause a big fire very quickly if you've got combustible material around your array. Right, so what is all of this on this other board? So as I previously mentioned, there is a setting you can set in the grow watt inverters where, let's say you can set whether you've got solar as a priority or the grid as a priority, or you can stagger solar, battery, then grid. But because I have limited sun, I don't want to run the battery pack down so that if, let's say, there is a grid outage, I want at least 80, 70 or 80% of the battery available, because I know that would run me through the night quite easily and then charge up the next day. So I want to disconnect and go back to the grid when the sun sets or when it goes behind the trees and I'm generating low power. Now, what is low power for me? I showed you I need about 700 to 800 watts to run my cabin. So as soon as the sun goes down behind the trees, my power drops to like 600, 300 watts, and as we move around from, let's say, 3:30 to around 4 o'clock, or just after 4, around 5, I'm down to 300 watts. So basically what's happening then is I'm pulling 500 watts out of the battery and getting 300 watts from solar. So I'm draining the battery. And because there is a voltage that is seen on the array right up until, let's say, 8 or 9 o'clock at night, it doesn't switch across to the grid, and it continues at that point. There's no power coming in. You're fully running off the batteries and running the batteries down. So I've got a system where I've got this timer over here. It's a DC clock. I've got a little, obviously, a wall wart down over here running it. And these are two solid state relays. I want you to, important note, and we're going to talk about this, rated for 40 amp. These are $13. Do you think you're going to get a 40 amp rated relay for $13? I don't think so. But anyway, so this switches these, and I have as a protection here 5 amp breakers, and then I switch on to halogen lamps. To basically, this directly couples the halogen lamps across the arrays. So basically what I'm doing is I'm diverting the power into the halogen lamps
so that eventually the inverters see a 0 volt and then force them across to the grid. Now last night, yesterday, I'm going to insert a piece of video here. I might cut it because it was, last night was a difficult situation where, because there was clouds in the sky, even though the sun had gone down behind the trees and I'd normally cut across at that point in time, the clouds were creating dispersed light, generating more energy. So even when I switched across, there was still more energy coming in. So even though the halogens were burning off what was there, what they could, the inverters were still seeing a voltage, and it took a little while before it cut across. But anyway, eventually it did cut across, and I'll just insert some of that video to demonstrate how the system works.
Right then, so it's at this time of day, you can see on each of the panels, I'm pulling in less than 300 watts at this point in time. So my cabin is using a fair bit more than is coming in. If we come down, that's the time of day, so just after 5, I've actually set this for 10 past 5. So at 10 past 5, this is going to trigger and activate those solid state relays. And those solid state relays, when they're activated, you'll see a red light come on each of them. They go through these breakers. These are 5 amp breakers, DC breakers, just as a precaution. And they will activate those 2 halogen lights to act as 2 dummy loads to draw down directly off the panels the remaining power, so that the inverter doesn't see any more power and switches across to the grid. If I didn't do this, the voltage on the panels, and I'll just go and show you, this is the operational voltage at the moment. That voltage would stay there until about 8:30 at night, and it just wouldn't switch across to the grid. So just to explain this diagram, you can see a little power pole that is showing it's not connected to the loads. You can see the PV is now feeding the loads with the battery. So both the PV and the battery, nothing from the grid. So if we come and look and see what's being drawn out of the batteries, you can see now we're pulling out a bit of current. So this is switching through each of the packs. So each time you see this change, that is what is being drawn out of each of the packs. So we're probably looking at roughly 10 amp in total. So here we go. We are just a little way away from the clock hitting 10 past 5. I'll just confirm that. Yeah, that's the setting. There we go. 5 seconds to go. So if you keep an eye on the 2 red lights on the solid state relays, bang, we see they go on. There are the 2 halogens which have switched on. You can see the kind of current readings there kind of freeze. And what's going to happen if we keep an eye on here, we can see the solar panel is no longer providing power to the inverter. And what we should see in a short while, it'll realize that and it'll disconnect and reconnect to the grid. You heard the relay click. The little solar panel has disappeared. And soon we should see that little power pole, it'll switch over, and that'll supply, it'll switch from the batteries to the grid. There we go, 0 volts. So here's an interesting case. What has happened, because there's clouds in the sky, it's actually dispersing the light more than it would if the sun was setting in a clear sky. So it's actually creating more power than you would normally have. And that's literally because of the light dispersion. So this relay has now clicked in. Oh, now it's clicked out again. So I've caught it just at the cusp where the load on the halogens is only just equaling what is on the panels, what it can actually dissipate. So let's just see now if it's going to switch across. You can see it's saying PV 55 volt. And if we look up here, this is that second array. We can see at the moment there's still just enough power. It's sitting at 140. The top one at 123 has pulled the voltage down enough. So for a moment, this PV panel disappeared, but we're still right on the cusp. We'll just keep an eye on it. So there we go. Below 55 volts is obviously its threshold. And I can see the volt. If you look there, you can see the voltage slowly dropping off. So just out of interest, this one is showing at about 44 volts. You can see PV1, it's dropping a bit low. The other one's at 48.
49, and you can see, so that is still registering. So it is still seeing voltage there, and hence it hasn't cut across yet. Oh, there we go, it's just gone to zero. So now, in theory, there we go. It's just switched across and is now running off the grid.
So the dummy load has done its job. As you can see, that is now the power that's coming in directly off the solar panels and is now running these halogen lights. So in effect, these will follow the sun. So as the sun slowly sets, these will obviously dim down to nothing as we hit twilight and nighttime. And now if we have a look at the power draw from the battery, it is basically negligible. So it'll stay, this is what the inverter requires to run. You can see one of them is already in a standby mode, the one that's showing 0 amps. And in a little time from now, it'll eventually hit a point where the current draw is so low, the battery will actually go into standby. But at least it's doing this, I say, at like 5 o'clock or just after 5 o'clock in the afternoon, as opposed to another 3 hours, I'd be running, let's say 600 to 800 watts would be running out of the battery itself.
Right then, so after that demonstration of how my kind of dummy load sheds the power so that it forces off to the grid, is there a better system? And certainly there is, as I said, the ideal solution would be to have a, let's say, a solid state relay which is directly in line in series with the array, so that I don't divert power to, let's say, halogen lamps, which is kind of wasteful, unless you find a device, let's say a heating element, to heat water with that additional power. But there's not much power, say, once the sun goes behind the trees. But so you could have a solid state relay to switch out, just break the connection to the array. However, I cannot find any solid state relays with a rating that I can trust for where they've been produced and the connections. I mean, I wouldn't put 40 amp through that solid state relay. It only carries about 2 to 3 amp. I trust it with 2 to 3 amp. I wouldn't trust it with 20 or 30 amp. You do get, however, I've done some research, because this is something I say, if I find that I'm not happy with how this dummy load solution works, you can get solenoid-based relays. So basically it's a relay which has got a solenoid with a contactor which can handle hundreds of amps and high voltage as well. I believe they're used in systems like golf carts and winches and what have you. And often you'll see them in a can, and you've got a coil, you can operate with 12 volt or 24 volt, and then it'll actually move a contactor inside. And that would perhaps be a better solution than the dummy load. But for now, I say the dummy load solution is working quite happily for me. So unless I see it has got any real issues, I'll continue using it. Because I say, it does switch my system back over to the grid at around 5 o'clock or just after, depending on the lighting conditions. And that means it's not running for an additional 3 hours and drawing all that out of my panels. And then what happens in the morning, I only switch it off at around 9 o'clock. So I don't want the system switching back off the grid until 9 o'clock in the morning, because again, there's not much power. So basically you're just sucking energy out of the batteries, and I want to maintain a healthy reserve in case there are any power outages. Do we get any power outages here in America? Anyway, so that's the reason why I want a backup reserve. And it's perfect because my work day when I arrive here is just literally around 9 o'clock in the morning, and I leave here anywhere between 5 and 6 o'clock at night. So my full work day and the charging of my vehicle is all covered off solar. And then I think I've mentioned in a previous video, if I needed to run off this, let's say there was an extended power outage, I could reduce the power consumption inside my cabin so that basically I could run perpetually off the sun and the battery system if I carefully manage how I use my power. Like if I was going to do any heavy power usage, do it during the day when you've got solar, and you reduce your power usage at night. But anyway, I hope that this video has been of value. There are, I said, there are many rabbit holes in terms of going into the challenges with the electrical system on my cabin, talking about what qualified electricians do or don't do in my own personal experience. We're going to look at DC arc faults, DC protection systems, and we are going to test a host of DC breakers, because I think people need to be very mindful about how dangerous these can be, in particular the polarized ones. If you don't connect them up correctly, they are just an accident waiting to happen. It's almost not an if it'll happen, but when it'll happen. Anyway, thanks very much for watching this video, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.